Ham Radio Now, episode 168, DATV Express. Another talk from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference back in Austin, Texas, in September. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, still here at the beach. We see that? Yeah, still here at the beach. Doesn't look like the beach, but that's where I am, in the bedroom studio of the beach house that I put all together. When this episode is done, I've got to pack everything up and haul it all back home. Sad. I want to stay another week. So DATV Express, well, it's a new product being developed by hams in the digital amateur television community. Not a big company, but just, you know, a bunch of hams doing the open source thing. This presentation is by Ken Konechy, W6HHC. Ken's talked about ATV before on the DCC here on Ham Radio Now, but he's always done it remotely from his home in California. And this time, he's here live and in person. There was a little confusion, maybe more than a little confusion, among hams when the U.S. broadcast television system transitioned to all digital in 2009. Was it really that long ago? Seems like only yesterday. Hams were not required to go digital. We can still operate analog today. And although most hams use who are doing ATV use the same NTSC amplitude modulation standard that the analog broadcasters did, you know, back in the day, we were never restricted to that mode like they were. FM was also a popular mode, and it had some advantages. And although we're not required to go digital today, and we probably won't be, maybe not ever, hams have discovered there are some significant advantages to going digital. Two of them are a noise-free picture and the ability to vary the bandwidth needed to something well below the 6 megahertz that you need for an NTSC analog channel. So being noise-free and low bandwidth are two of the same advantages that we've talked about a lot for digital voice. So it works on TV too. And we hams are also not restricted to the digital system that is being used for the American broadcast television. There are a bunch of digital formats. They're used for satellite video, different ones for remote trucks. There are different digital systems in use terrestrially for systems in different parts of the world. Hams can pick from any of them. And as I understand it, we can develop new ones as long as they are using a published code that our rules require. Digital amateur television is still pretty much experimental, of course. Hams have been repurposing equipment from other services. There's been some stuff built in Europe specifically for digital ATV, and that's been discussed in previous talks at the DCC and available on Ham Radio Now. I'll try to put up some links to those. It's been on the expensive side. Ken's going to talk about that. He says that DATV Express, the hardware and software that he's working on now, is being developed to be both very flexible, it is an SDR, and less expensive. To be sure, amateur television, whether it's analog or digital, is a niche interest. I don't have a world census, but I am going to guess it runs in the low thousands of hams using digital ATV, even if it's that high. It's something we're always talking about when we describe amateur radio to the public. You know, we always say, we've got television, but not very many of us actually use it. One ATV active ham that I talked to recently said one of the problems is, well, there's not really much programming. Nothing much interesting to see after you've watched a ham sitting in his ham shack for a few hours, talking into the microphone and looking at you on his monitor. I know that there's an Australian group that helps fill the time on their ATV network by playing Ham Radio Now. So, shout out to you guys. Better modes, where do we go? Better modes, less expensive equipment, maybe that will generate more interest. And we'll figure out how to show something to each other. You know, home movies, things like that. Always had trouble getting hams to do good video for this program or for, I guess, for ATV. All right, we're going to get to Ken's talk in just a minute. But first, I need to acknowledge the folks who make this series of programs from the DCC possible on Ham Radio Now. Those are our Kickstarter backers. It begins with the 108 hams who contributed between $10 and $150 as individuals. And then there are the $500 corporate underwriters. And they're going to get this little plug at the top of all the programs. They are hit me with this here.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry, who actually did the contribution, is KF5SLN. His host on the No Agenda show is John C. Dvorak. He is also a ham, KJ6LNG. The No Agenda Show is a twice-weekly audio podcast. It takes apart politics, the media, entertainment, anything in this world that needs to be taken out and beaten. And you can listen to the program on their website. That's noagendashow.com. And I think it's available on most podcast apps. So thank you, Adam. In the morning to you. If you watch the show, you know what I'm saying. The DCC series also brought to you by TAPR. TAPR is the sponsor of the DCC, of course, and if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, be it hardware, software, data, voice modes, you will find a home in TAPR. If you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a TAPR member, please consider joining. Stop by their website, tapr.org, and check them out. We're also brought to you by several hams who would like to encourage you to look into this. It's hackersforcharity.org. It's a nonprofit organization that leverages the skills of technologists to solve technology challenges for various nonprofits. And they provide food, equipment, job training, and computer education to the world's poorest citizens. That's hackersforcharity.org. We're also brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. They are at aretf.org. The mission of the aretf is to make amateur radio digital networks work better by producing high-quality, relevant, technical documents that influence the way people design, use, and manage amateur radio networks. If you're involved in a digital network and you're wondering if there's any standards out there to guide you, or you want to contribute to the development of standards and recommendations, check out the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force, aretf.org. And finally, we are brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and TAPR, who wishes to remain anonymous. This ham's a regular attendee of the DCC. He's been going there for over 30 years, and he is very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are doing together, and he wanted very much to help us do that. Thanks to all you guys and all the 108 contributors below the corporate level. Thanks to all of you as well. And although we did collect the $8,000 that got us out there and is paying for a lot of the production, that's just kind of barely covering it. So if you didn't contribute to that, you can still stop by hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's icon, and make a contribution. It'll go to the general fund, this and all the other programs that we do. Another quick reminder is that I had promised the Kickstarter backers 30 days of exclusive viewing before putting each program online for them, or for everyone. It turns out many of them appreciated the thought, but they preferred that I not delay distribution, because the whole idea of TAPR is the open, free exchange of ideas. Getting an exclusive look at the talk for a month didn't influence their decision to contribute to the Kickstarter. I surveyed all of the backers. Those who responded were unanimous. Well, okay, one of them was worried that I would see a backlash, but so far I haven't. If you're a Kickstarter backer and you want me to do that delay thing, let me know. Although it would, you know, kind of be tough for you because it would cast you as the Grinch. I won't tell people who you are. It'll just put me in the difficult position of deciding what to do about it. I like the idea that the ham said it's open source. The information needs to be out there. You know, information wants to be free. It costs money to do this. That's why the Kickstarter. You know, when I go to lunch here, they're going to give me a check at the end of the meal and they'll want to be paid. I have to get that money from someplace. And it turns out that it's, in large part, it's from you. Okay, now normally I would toss the program over to TAPR President Steve Bible, N7HPR, and he would introduce the session. But this time, and only for this time as far as I know, I had some technical trouble. When I pushed the record button here on the Wirecast system, little record button up there, I got the dreaded error message. And it was in the usual cryptic style that you see when something's gone wrong. It had some codes and a little bit of technobabble in it that didn't mean anything to me, and it was nothing useful in helping me quickly diagnose the problem. So, well, Steve waited to start Ken's session for a minute or two, but when I couldn't figure things out right away, I didn't want to slow down the DCC and throw it off schedule, so I told him to go ahead. I had visions of losing the entire conference, you know, battling this equipment for the next 2 days, trying to make it work and not having any idea what was wrong. I wasn't even sure that I had successfully recorded the previous talk, the one from Bruce Perrins on the Ambi vocoder. Of course, as you know now, that was successfully recorded. A useful error message in this case would have said something like, hard drive full. And oh, by the way, you've been recording to the wrong hard drive, you idiot. Wirecast usually keeps recording to the last drive that was used. I've got a couple of multi-terabyte bays here in this portable computer thing here. I guess it's sort of a luggable computer. It's hardly a laptop. Once in a while, Wirecast gets confused. It points itself to the drive that has its setup files in it. It's a relatively small drive. It won't hold a lot of video. I thought that I had checked to make sure I was going to the correct drive. I do that as often as I can. But apparently, I hadn't looked hard enough. And Wirecast successfully, yay, recorded Bruce's talk to that little drive. It had just enough space for a couple of gigabytes that Bruce took up, but it filled it up right at the very end of that talk. There was no room to even start Ken's talk. Well, I found the problem fairly quickly once the glare of everybody waiting for me was off. So we only lost a couple of minutes of Ken's talk. And so now we take you back to the DCC in Austin, Texas, for Ken Konechy W6HHC and DATV Express. Already in progress.
Slideshow. The video quality really exceeds what you can achieve with analog technology. But the problem is that even today, there's very few hams in the United States using digital amateur television. There's quite a few hams who use analog mode technology, basically started up in the 1960s and continues on today, quite widespread repeaters using analog. But the quality can suffer depending on your location and what the band conditions are. Things are a little bit different in Europe. DATV in Europe is very, very active and growing. They were the people who produced the first equipment capable of producing digital television for hams. Even if you go to Australia or New Zealand, you'll find there's more activity with digital amateur television there than there is in the United States. One of the problems is currently digital amateur televisions are very expensive. Up till the end of last year, it would cost about $900 to buy a ham-grade transmitter and encoder, usually coming in from Germany. They were making very good quality, but it was pretty expensive. And at least my feeling is that the cost of a transmitter is a barrier to people just trying it out. You got to spend $900 to try it out. You're not sure about doing that. Unless you see everybody else in your neighborhood using that, you're not going to be the first guy to put out $900. So a few hams got together and decided to start a project called the DATV Express Project to do something about the problem. And the main goal was to reduce the price of digital amateur television transmitters, basically to provide an easy-to-use product that you didn't have to solder SMT components together to make it work, provide an open platform for future development, and to help. The project is intended to advertise the capabilities a lot and then educate the hams about the new technologies. Our real goal is to get more DATV stations on the air. And there's a lot of software hackers out there. If we can give them an interesting platform to play with and software to play with, maybe we can get more licensed hams out of the software hacker area. The four hams part of the DATV Express team are Charles G4 GUO out of England, He's our software guru and our resident mathematician. I'm Ken, out of the city of Orange in California. I play the role of project manager, and I work for the publications department of our team. Art WA8RMC is in Columbus, and he's basically our electrical engineer. And then Tom WB6Papa up in Portland, Oregon, does our schematic capture and our printed circuit board layout. So it's a small team, but we work well together. We've never met each other. We just do everything by either email or Skype. This is a block diagram of a typical DVB-S transmitter. Using our board, the main component is that you start by putting a camera and audio into an MPEG-2 encoder that through USB will connect to a PC that does a lot of the processing. And basically, the current product is designed to use Ubuntu OS, either the 32-bit variety or the 64-bit variety. It takes the information, the elementary program streams coming from the MPEG-2 encoder, and starts to turn them into the protocol that's used for DVB-S or any of the other television protocols that the hams are using. It then sends the signal over to the printed circuit board that we designed as part of the project through USB. Basically, it's a FPGA-based board that can run any of the ham bands for television from let's say the 200 megahertz region up to 2400 megahertz. And it has basically does some filtering and some processing of the IQ stream that's coming in from the main PC, and basically then has an IQ modulator that will allow us to do the QPSK modulation that you would need for DVB-S2. Right now, we can produce about somewhere between 1 and 10 milliwatts of power out of the exciter, and send that over to probably two stages of RF amplifiers. Typically, I get about 6 to 8 watts of output power that I send up to the antenna. Here's a block diagram of the FPGA board that we designed. Basically, this is the USB connector that takes the input coming from the PC, which is most of the information needed to do the modulation. Got a USB controller from Cypress that has a little built-in 8051 microprocessor that allows us to do some housekeeping task. There's an Altera FPGA that basically takes the IQ streams, does some filtering on it and processing on it. And then basically one stream, the I stream, is sent to a digital analog converter, and the Q stream is sent to another one. We do a little bit of low-pass filtering to get rid of the aliasing problems that you can run into depending on your symbol rate. And then we use a modulator from Analog Devices that has a built-in PLL that goes right up to the 2400 megahertz. Put a little buffer amplifier on the end of it to protect the rest of the circuitry and just give a little boost to the signal. And then there's a cluster of DC to DC converters so that you only need one voltage coming onto the board. There's a picture of the actual board. Basically, this is the USB connector. It goes to the Cypress USB controller. Have an FPGA. Send the I and Q signals up to a DAC converter there. There's some discrete component low-pass filters, which goes to the modulator. There's a little buffer amplifier. And up here is the cluster of five different DC to DC voltages to produce all of the voltages you need on a particular on this particular board. Let's just kind of give an overview. The project and this board has been basically using the DVB-S protocol. That's what it was designed to do originally. It's been tested and released. because it's IQ modulations, there's lots of modulations that can be done. We've fully tested the QSPK. We've done some testing on other ones. The modulator itself is capable of any ham band from 70 megahertz up to 2400. And the symbol rates is basically we're designed to run anywhere from one mega symbol per second up to five mega symbols per second. There's some exceptions that, but you can get into aliasing problems and other things that you have to worry about either through software or through filters if you go outside those ranges. The forward error correction can be selectable. You can choose the value you need either to be compatible or for whatever your particular goals are. The RF output is somewhere in the neighborhood of 1 to 20 milliwatts. Depends a little bit on the band. At 1.2 gigahertz, we definitely can get 10 milliwatts out of there with no problem. We only are designed right now with the software for one video stream, but perhaps we'll change that in the future. And basically, we're only released right now for a PC operating Ubuntu, and we're hoping to move out of the big bulky PC or a notebook computer world into a smaller, more portable world very soon. We're kind of proud of this. It was our very first picture on our very first prototype board, and we had been working about a year and a half at this point, and we thought we knew what we were doing. We were hoping it would work, and when we got that picture, that made us feel pretty good. This is a spectrum analyzer picture of the output. This is a QPSK modulation on 1.2 gigahertz, and basically shows a nice, clean output coming from the design. The board itself has configurable RF output. You can have 47 different levels of RF, so you can really just tweak the level of output you need to drive your amplifier. Because it is SDR design and because it uses an IQ modulator, basically there's almost an untold number of different protocols and modulations you can use. And one of the first things we did after we showed that we could make DVBS and QPSK modulation work was to try something else. This is DVBT operating in a 2K mode. DVBT uses a coded orthogonal type of modulation and protocol. And I can't remember the exact number, but it's close to 2,000 discrete carriers. So there's 2,000 subcarriers all spaced orthogonally to each other. And we came out with a nice protocol. This particular signal, we're using something that's kind of good for ham radio. It reduces the normal bandwidth from about 6 or 8 megahertz down to 2 megahertz. And we were using this on the 400 megahertz band. And it's using a 4,096 point IFFT math. And the advantage of that is that even though the symbol rates are very low, there's no aliasing going on here. If we go down to about, I think, a 2,000 point IFTT math, you can see the aliasing starting to grow up because the symbol rates actually get pretty low since you have 2,000 carriers or subcarriers that are carrying the information for you. Again, the IQ modulator and the software-defined radio base allows it to do lots of modulations. Here's another modulation. It's called 16APSK. And this is a constellation from it. There's an advanced protocol called DVBS2 that uses some other modulations. It was designed to bring in high-definition television. You can use it with standard-definition television or high-definition television. But I can tell you the high-definition television has a lot of extra bits going along, and so the bandwidth tends to increase. Again, just as an example that you can do all kind of modulations. That's the advantage of SDR. This is doing a single sideband test. We just wanted to see how good the quality of the printed circuit board design was. And this is a 1 megahertz lower sideband tone that we're creating a single sideband signal with. This is the unsuppressed carrier coming out of the board, and you can see that it's 60 dBs down. And then we can use other software techniques to filter and suppress the carrier and the upper sideband. This is a very simple user interface that we use on the PC. Basically, it has a number of tabs where you can select what type of protocol you want to use for digital amateur television, set up and configure all of the settings there. And in this particular, the main is showing that I set this up for DVBS, and I have a forward error correction of 1/2, and I'm sending a signal out with 4 mega symbols per second on a frequency of 1.29 megahertz. And on the bottom is a messaging area so that if everything is running normal, like these particular messages, then you're happy. And if something is wrong, like you forgot to plug in your MPEG-2 encoder power supply, you'll get some type of an error message over here. People are starting to do new things with the radio that and the project that we hadn't done before in a new radio world. Alex OZ9AEC has developed a new radio sync module for the DATV Express board, and at the end of this presentation, you'll see a URL for his GitHub. Ron W6 Romeo Z has used or adapted new radio to run DVB-2 in the modulation scheme called 32APSK. Basically, he's using our software code for DVB-S2 and using on another piece of hardware called Blade RF. And he's running signals up to 10 mega symbols per second. And he was nice enough to send me this constellation printout of the 32 APSK modulation from his test equipment. Okay, so let's talk about the project status now using a PC. Basically, the production board was released on February of this year. You can order it either from our website at datvexpress.com or the British Amateur Television Club has an online shop that you can order it for England. That's mainly for shipments into England. We ship worldwide out of our office in the state of Ohio, and ship, I think the last batch had been going out to Japan. The DVB-S protocol is complete and stable, and works very well. And this board and project was really geared up and centered on the DVB-S modulation and protocol, which uses QPSK modulation. But because it's software defined, we knew we could probably do other things. And one of the things that we've tested is the DVB-T in the 2K mode, and it stretches the performance of the hardware board a little bit, but we certainly can do 2K modulation pretty well, especially if you get into the low bandwidth type of uses of this board. It works very nicely. We've also done some testing with the DVB-S2 modulation that is currently being used for satellite transmissions of high definition, but as Bruce points out, sometimes there's issues out there, and there are some licensing issues, and we're not shipping out that software code right now. But a couple people are playing with it and just doing some development with it. Really, our next development goal is to eliminate a bulky PC. It kind of cuts down on portability. So to go more portable, we got to get rid of the bulky PC or notebook, and I'd like to use the term micro PC. There's a number of boards out there, single board computers that I call micro PCs, that can do more of, can replace a big bulky PC. And one of the goals is to put more functionality into the FPGA so that the load, the CPU processing load on the micro PC is reduced from a full-blown PC. And we've been looking at a number of different single board computers. Maybe we'll use the Raspberry Pi, or there's a company called Rico Magic that has a very nice quad-core ARM processor out there. And there's another company that has a really nice product called Hard Kernel out of Korea. So we took a look at the Raspberry Pi. So we finished the project in February. We took a month or two to do some, you know, fix all the little bugs that you always overlook. And then we started looking at the Raspberry Pi. And Raspberry Pi basically is a single core ARM single board computer that runs at 700 megahertz. Typically the operating system that hams like to look at is Raspbian operating system. And if you look at the background of this project, it was originally designed for the education market. And that leaves a few things high and dry because, well, the Raspberry Pi is seriously underpowered for our particular application. It does a lot of things wonderful. And in the education market, it's a terrific education tool for students in a school. Another problem is the Raspbian source code repository is incomplete, and we are not able to recompile the kernel, which we wanted to do to do some tweaks for our particular project. So we looked at another ARM-based micro PC. There's a company called Rico Magic that has a very nice MK8024. It has a quad core ARM processor that runs at 1.4 gigahertz. And basically, one of the operating systems that's available for that is Pekuntu, which is a very lightweight Ubuntu. It doesn't have all of the bells and whistles of libraries and functions that Ubuntu normally ships with. The market for the MK8024 was an option that consumers could buy to turn their television into a smart TV to surf the internet or download movies. But the problem we ran into is the Pekuntu source code repository, again, is incomplete. The Rico Magic guys are doing their thing, and they're not really aiming their product at software developers. And also, the current way they ship the kernel, it doesn't balance the loads on the four CPUs very well. But it's a nice product. I mean, I really enjoyed using it and transmitting it. You can see it's very small. And the connector you see sticking out here is an HDMI connector. It was designed to plug right into the back of your television. It has built-in Bluetooth, has built-in Wi-Fi, so you can be sitting on your couch with a keyboard and talking right to it and surfing the internet. And we just tried to repurpose this to do a little bit of ham radio games with it. Okay, so the next product we looked at, well, maybe we can do better. And we found this company, Hard Kernel, that has a family of products called Odroid, and we looked at a particular model called the U3. The U3 has a quad-core ARM processor in it that's running at 1.7 gigahertz. It comes with a OS called Lubuntu, which is basically Ubuntu with an LDE desktop configured on it. And its target audience was a software developer. They're actually trying to sell to software developers to turn this into all type of products. And from our perspective, the good news is it has a very active software community for support, has a complete repository of the source code so we can easily recompile the kernel, and they have lots of documentation on how to recompile the kernel. And as our software guru, Charles G4UO, says that once we get the DATV Express project satisfied with a release for the ARM, actually we'll probably be able to work with most of the ARM products. It's just that we can't work with everything, so we'll focus our attention on the ODroid, and then basically other people are free to go and move in different directions with different products for whatever they want to do. And there's a picture of the ODroid U3 unit. Again, it's about the same size as a Raspberry Pi. Has a very nice heat sink on it. You notice Raspberry Pi people always talk about overheating. Actually, even the Ricoh Magic people talk about overheating. That heat sink doesn't overheat. And here's a block diagram of how we would use the ODroid 3, easy for me to pronounce. Basically, you have an MPEG-2 encoder getting the inputs from a camera, the video, and the source. You put it into the micro PC, which is running Ubuntu, in this case version 12.4. And it's taking the elementary picture files, streams from here, and preparing the transport stream. It's doing the user interface using QT4 and sends a signal over to the DATV Express board by USB. Now we've recoded the FPGA to do more functions. So basically, it's taking the transport stream, but now it's doing the encoding of the DVBS protocol right on the FPGA board, and doing the PEC and doing the some filtering, plus the modulation, and then you have the two filters over here. This is more portable because the items you see in a dashed line here, like a display, the mouse and a keyboard, and a hub to get enough ports going, they're only needed for setting up and configuring the board, the software. So they're very removable. You're just going to have a push-to-talk switch you wire into the hardware board, and you can remove these after you've done your configuration. Okay, let's kind of finish everything up. Basically, on a PC, Ubuntu 32-bit and 64-bit is finished. Always like to put out a plea that we're always looking for software volunteers to help with the project. We started last year asking for volunteers, but as G4GUL reports, the people who have given us genuine offers don't have the software skills at the level we're working with that really help with us. And the people who have those skills don't have the time because they're busy on other projects. So always like to put out a plea. Our focus right now is replacing bulky PCs with ARM-based micro PCs. Our plan is all the source files will be available, the software code, source code, the FPGA coding, the schematic capture files, the Gerber files, everything will be available. And G4GUO has started to put it up on a GitHub at this particular location. And I always like to wind up with a page full of URLs. So if you're interested in amateur television, digital amateur television, there's the British Amateur Television Club. It has a terrific digital forum. Here's an online magazine that's free every month, CQDATV. I'm a member of the Orange County Amateur Radio Club, and I've put together a full library of all the DATV articles that I've written for our newsletter. Covers lots of different protocols. TAPR, of course, has a website that has all of the conference proceedings up there, free to download. I'm sure this year will go on there probably in a couple weeks after the sessions close. There's a very active digital a Yahoo group for digital amateur television. And then, of course, there's our own project website where you can look at the specs and a number of user manuals, as well as get the code or buy a board. So I think that's all I wanted to talk about right now. Are there any questions out there? We have a question over here.
Yes, Ken, thank you for a wonderful presentation. I might ask the dumbest question in the room, but how do these ARM processors and your software work with real-time digital signal processing, where maybe you wave on the screen or you speak? How does that go?
Yeah, in digital amateur television, actually it doesn't even have to be amateur television, the compression that goes on for the video and the audio has a lag time. And basically it's called latency, and usually it takes about 1 second for the cheaper type of encoders to basically take shortcuts to compress the data, which in the case of a video signal, you might start off with the camera putting out somewhere in the neighborhood, I'm trying to remember from numbers here, somewhere in the neighborhood of 700 kilobits per second, and you got to compress that down to something more usable, and actually I think it's 700 megabits per second, and you have to compress that down. I've been running usually about 3 megabits per second of symbol rate, and actually less than that, about 2.2. I don't know if that answers your question or not. So if you hand wave, it takes about a second before the other station will see it. But he doesn't know when you really did it. You see it mostly, it shows up when you turn it over to somebody else. You'll get about a 1 or 2 second delay while it's finally getting over to him. Are there any other questions? Okay.
Yes, the DATV Express board, What FPGA and development tools did you use for it?
Which components are on there? The FPGA?
Altera.
Oh, it's an Altera. It's a Cypress 2. Okay. I'm going from memory. I think it was like 100 and some pins. I can't remember. It was a lot of pins.
Did you use the Altera Cortis development tools?
Altera?
Cortis development tools, because those are freely available
right, exactly.
tools.
Okay. And they were the free ones that we used. So. Didn't get into the licensing.
So where are you heading in the future? I mean, what you talked about needing some software help and all, but what's your roadmap? Where's the long term?
Well, there's a lot of things we want to do that we haven't done yet, and that is that, for example, we want to do this portable ARM-based type of micro PC project. We haven't finished that yet. There are other things we're thinking about, and that is maybe turning this into a transceiver and being able to have the receiver and the transmitter under the same control of one ARM microprocessor. That's an area I haven't talked about very much. The receivers are pretty simple up till now, but usually you can buy satellite receivers, set-top boxes that come for satellites. You can get a used one for like $50, and they're pretty cheap. Some people are using a cable-capable television for some modes of digital amateur television. But there's a move in technology right now because spectrums are under a lot of pressure to either get rid of a ham band or how do you fit a 10 megahertz wide signal into a band that is fully established? And so I see a lot of activity going into smaller and smaller bandwidth signals. I'm operating a 3 megahertz bandwidth right now, and there's a lot of people starting to use 2 megahertz bandwidth, and there are people who are starting 1 megahertz bandwidth, and that can be done. And so, and there's a problem with that. The receivers that you buy commercially don't normally go down that low. The symbol rates they're playing with just don't work that way. And so hams are starting to now tinker with getting inside the receivers and changing the registers and the values and the code inside of a commercial receiver so that it works there. Hopefully I answered your question. At least that's a little bit. I think we're out of time, so why don't I...
Oh. I have one more question.
Okay.
Are the little DVB-T dongles that you can buy for $20, are they usable at all for doing receive, or are they the right?
Oh, okay. I think you're talking about the video capture dongles. Yeah?
RT The RTL dongles, the ones that do the digital TV broadcast.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess I didn't realize they were that low cost. I've been working with a company called High Design that you're going to hear about in just a few minutes at the next presentation. They're not down in a $20 region yet, but they're really one of the reasons. I said there's about a $900 barrier for a transmitter. They brought it down to, I'm sure Mel will tell you better, but I think it's down in the $200 region or $250 region. This board that we have is $300 right now, and as soon as we get some of our expenses out of it, it'll be even lower. So the answer is yes, there are, and you can do that, although I don't have experience with that $20 dongle.
Okay, well, these are just receivers only, just very small.
Yeah,
look like a USB
there's
stick.
There's a company called Hi-Des out of Taiwan, and I think they make dongles for receivers and transmitters. They make them for receivers, and but they're not down to the eBay-type pricing that I think I hear you telling me yet, but maybe next year I can talk about that.
There you go. There's an idea. Thank you very much, Ken.
Okay, thank you.